Houston, say again, please.
Houston, we've had a problem. We've had a main beam undervolt.
Roger, main beam undervolt. Okay, stand by, 13, we're looking at it.
Okay, right now, Houston, the voltage is looking good. And we had a pretty large bank associated with the caution and warning there. And as I recall, BB was the one that had an amp spike on it once before.
Roger, Fred.
In the interim here, we're starting to go ahead and button up the tunnel again.
Roger.
Yeah, that jolt must have rocked the sensor now in O2 quantity 2. It's was oscillating down around 20 to 60%. Now it's full scale high.
Roger.
And Houston, we have to restart on our computer. We have pink light and restart reset.
Roger, restart. And our pink light. Restart on the plane.
Okay.
Reset.
And we're looking at this.
Was there ever anything so interesting to you that you were so inspired by that you'd do almost anything to learn more about it? Were you naturally engaged by things? Now think about those things, you know, those things that you were engaged by. Were they dinosaurs? Were they cars? Were they fire trucks? Were they planes, trains, spaceships, castles? Horses. Kids come to us already excited about some kinds of things, and they come to us in school, and you know, we can feed those interests that they have. It's not always easy because it doesn't always fit curriculum, you know, but the one thing we absolutely cannot do is talk them out of their excitement, you know? So for me, when I was a kid, one of the things I was most interested in the whole world was the space program. There was something about that mission of those guys heading to the moon.
So phase one, research. We gotta become right now experts. I'm counting on you to become right now experts in your field, in these rooms upstairs with your leaders, okay? Know everything you can. I wanna be able to ask anyone in this room any question I want, and I want you to know the answer.
The command module is a third of the whole Apollo.
We still have the same.
It's gonna be 2 feet.
At the base, we still have the same height or the same width.
You know, it's still gonna be 6 feet high.
6.4.
As I went on through Through my elementary education, I had heard tale of another program that was underway, and it was the Orbiter program. I had book covers with pictures of the space shuttle on it, and I followed with great interest. Of course, you could have hooked me in space science, math, measurements, problem solving, anything you want if you'd have tied it to space science. Of course, you could have talked me out of that same interest by not giving it any kind of context. And that happened a lot.
In there, so you create an experience for people to know how you ate out of a tube, you know what I mean? But if you think about the ways, your powdered food, wonderful idea. What are some other ways we could make or simulate food in space? You know what I mean?
I don't like bacon.
Now I'm working on the website and I'm getting all the pages configured, I guess you can say, making sure they're all in the right spots and they're all looking spiffy.
A paper model to help us better understand the Apollo 13.
I'm standing here in the gift shop at the Cosmosphere and Space Center in Hutchinson, Kansas. And if you've not been to Hutchinson, Kansas, you need to come here. You're always driving through Kansas on 70 on the way to Colorado, and you do not go south, and you should, right there at Hutchinson, because one of the best premier space museums in the world is right here. The Apollo 13 capsule is here. Now, you have to come here to see this. Some of the things you see in the background, well, I'm a 10-year-old boy every time I come here. That's just what happens. We have this chance to hook kids and hook their interest in things that they naturally like. We have a chance to connect to those things with project-based learning. We have a chance to connect to experts in other places through Skype. We have a chance to open their world in ways we've never, ever done before. I just can't see how we could pass that up.
I'm using the beakers in there right now to measure how high it's going to be, the height. Originally typed in Apollo food, and it brought me to what they used.
Okay. So, spacesuit people, raise your hand, spacesuit people. We absolutely need a spacesuit, but we might not need the whole spacesuit. We absolutely need at least a helmet and a glove. If we have time for this, yes. If we get to noon and this ain't done, or even close, make these two things amazing.
How are we gonna show the scene actually where the capsule is flying off? I was thinking that we could drill a hole through it and then put some wire in and then show it like dropping off, and we'd have duct tape on the bottom.
So how do we remix learning? And should we remix learning? Well, let's think about what we've always had. What has learning always been? I mean, you had books, you had experts, you came to a building where the experts were, and if you were lucky, you got to use their books. And that was learning. And you could learn from a person if you knew that person. I mean, you had to be pretty lucky, right? I mean, then you came to public schools where you could get a hold of some books and you could learn from those resource books, and there were experts in the room, the teachers, and you could learn. That was great. And then everything else in the world happened. Can you imagine the kind of learning kids could be doing now? I mean, if the Renaissance, right, was ushered in by the printing press, I mean, nothing less than the age of discovery, that people could learn because books were affordable to the masses. What should the web and voice over IP and blogs and podcasts and ubiquitous access to knowledge be doing for learning? And is that happening? That's the question.
And that's where we finally landed up in space with the Apollo 13. It's a mission. It was a successful failure, and that nobody died, and that people learned a lot from that. And that's almost where we are here. Our project was a successful success, I think. I don't know, failure's built in everywhere. I want students to make mistakes and be okay with it, so.
But what does it mean to remix learning? Well, I think it's taking all the things that exist and all the things that did exist and putting them together to make new ways to learn. Kids are telling us what they want to learn and how they want to learn every minute. It's just when they get to school, we amputate their digital limbs. We're moving at glacial speeds at a time when we need to be moving faster. As I make my way through the Hall of Space Museum here at the Hutchinson Cosmosphere and Space Center, I'm struck by something that, well, I think frankly should be the case in public schools. That you come to a museum and it's interesting, not just interesting, compelling, engaging, amazingly thought-provoking and well laid out. Lit well. Right, if Applebee's can be lit theatrically and interestingly to make your food more appealing, why can't we do more with the classroom? But I don't have a budget. How am I going to afford that? We don't have enough tools. You know, I hear a lot of reasons why we can't change things. But I want to hear more reasons why we can and should and must. Even if we don't have a lot of resources, if you've got the internet, you've got almost everything in the world. How do we make this interesting? How do we invite the kids to help us? It doesn't have to be us. We don't have to be some kind of crazy nest builders that make the perfect nest for little helpless chickies that are born into our care. They can help make their own nest, their own exciting learning environments. Something interesting happened when Sputnik flew over the world. America got a glimpse that they were not first in the space race all of a sudden. They had an amazing explosion of science. We redoubled our efforts to educate kids. We focused on the space race. We had a goal as a country. You know, maybe the goal now isn't the space race. Maybe it should be the education race. And I don't mean test scores. Good grief. Let's not do that. I mean, engaging kids in what they are passionate about and helping them to become world-class thinkers and learners, self-directed learners with the most powerful learning tools in human history.
The same, or be relatively the same.
Yes.
So...
But you're looking at Apollo 8.
Yeah. And Apollo 9, and Apollo 10, and Apollo 11, and Apollo 12, and Apollo 13.
And 13 is the only one with that.
No.
Ridge. Yep. As tall as it is.
Guys, we're gonna need another one. Okay.
All right. Oh, it likes me. I'm sticky.
You know, the web technology and today's tools prepare a buffet of learning choices, a buffet of learning opportunities for our kids. And for the most part, they're eating the napkins. How do we let kids get excited about their learning? How do we help them become stewards of information, builders of expert documents? I mean, it's all out there, right? They can be archaeologists of their own learning. There's so much out there and so many amazingly creative ways that these kids can share it with the world. They can have an authentic audience, or they can have an audience of one, you. Creativity and imagination have always been with us. And as many times that it was the writers and the thinkers who imagined the future that actually happened. You know, when I think of Jules Verne, you know, imagining a flight to space in a cast iron ship because he was mired in the technologies of his time. But what he pictured happened. Same thing with Gene Roddenberry. Much of what he pictured. What does your cell phone look like to you? A communicator?
I'm just a little anxious to get back to work and do something.
Listen,
huh?
If you will take a piece of thing, a piece of aluminum foil, and you will...
I gotcha. Keep going that way. Come this way. Oh.
We need an electric board out here.
No, bring it. Yeah, there you go. Oh. Clam. Okay, fixing crew, support crew, let's get in here.
We need the seat before we put these on.
Put the seats in.
Hey.
Yes.
Put the seat, drop them. We don't need them. We're going to put these in and then put those on.
We need them on.
Immersive environments that excite learners. Don't have any money? What can we do anyway? I'm not interested in what we can't do. I'm interested in what we can do. What can we do with almost no money to get kids excited about history, about science, about learning, about their ability to learn? You know what the killer app is for the 21st century? By the way, that's the Apollo 13 module back there. killer app for the 21st century is to learn to love to learn. To learn to love to learn. I don't care what it takes. We gotta do that. We gotta help kids learn to love to learn. To become right now learners, empowered learners who know they can learn what they need to, when they need to, how they need to, where they need to. Right? If we don't role model this, how are they gonna get it? So you crazies out there, you pioneers, good for you. Thank God for you. You get indicted, I know you do. People say things like, must be nice to have the time. And they're really indicting you. They're really saying you're doing that technology stuff while we're doing important feature stuff. Persist. Leaders out there, here's my charge to you. Protect your pioneers. If you don't protect your pioneers, we've got no innovation. And the world is changing too fast. The world is changing at exponential speeds, and we are moving at glacial speeds, and the misalignment is terrifying. How do we get in the game? How do we do that? How do we leverage networks of people like the ones watching this today and the people that are online right now? How do we help each other help these kids and get them ready? Get them ready for their future.
Hey, hold this.
On the other one?
No, one.
Yeah,
the one that doesn't have all the weight.
And are the great things for point four?
Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and put these sides.
My challenge to you today is to think new thoughts as an educator, to hit the reset button, to start over in your mind, to burn your intellectual file cabinet, to get rid of the laminated lesson plans, and to get excited. And I know you are. I mean, you're here. Be an advocate for other people. To become excited learners again, that can solve any problem, because failure is not an option. I'm inspired by what we've done, but I'm more inspired about what we can do, what our kids can do, if we believe in them and empower them. What will you do this year to make sure we keep moving forward? With all the amazing tools we have out there, we really have nothing unless we have amazing educators. And it's not just the amazing tools that we use, it's the relationships we form with kids. It's the belief in themselves. In what ways will you believe in kids this year? And how will they know it? How will your faith in them be manifest? I think kids can do anything. And if you think like me, you agree. Right? That doesn't mean anything if we don't get them to do it. How do we motivate them? How do we give them a work ethic so they start and finish things? So they don't just play with technology. They actually use it as the tool it was meant to be. The amazing, transformational tool that could save our world. Make a bright future for everyone, not just the kids. Let me close with this. I made this in my class with my kids when I was a jewelry teacher. This is metalsmithing. This is a little engine that could, if you will. Carved out of wax, it took weeks, right? We did a little measurement and we weighed it, the wax against metal, did a calculation, and we shot sterling silver into a mold. That process breaks the mold, so you can only ever make one of whatever the kid designed. And that's cool. One, right? Kind of made me sad because it's a lot of work for one. If you lose it, it's gone, right? So these days, what can we do to let kids be inventive, creative, entrepreneurs? Things have changed so much. So I was thinking about that Clovis point we talked about. And I thought, wouldn't it be cool if we could make this into a piece of wearable jewelry to make this point with people? So I drew a picture on a hotel room notepad. And I contacted a 16-year-old designer in Emporia, Kansas. This is Colby, Ginger Lumen's former student. He's still a student in Emporia, who happens to be really good with Google SketchUp software. And I asked him, can you work with me on this? Can you design the Clovis point as a piece of jewelry, which he did in 48 hours. And then we uploaded it to a site in the Netherlands called Shapeways. And in Shapeways, you can upload your design, and people can buy your design, print it in up to 20 different materials, and it costs nothing to set up your storefront.
What can you print it in? Stainless steel, glass, plastic, sterling silver, bronze, gold plate, anything. Now, first of all, could you afford to do that with your own foundry? What if we outsourced that? So that's what we did. This is what his design looked like when he first put it in the store. This is what it looks like when I bought it and it arrived in my mailbox. And this is what it looks like for a 16-year-old to have worldwide distribution, his own factory behind him. We could be doing this. We could be teaching business by letting kids be a business. Think about that. How do we teach business in school these days? We teach the tools. We teach tools. It's like teaching carpentry by teaching the hammer, right? What if we just let kids be a business? What if they get to keep their money? Would we ever do that? This necklace was designed by Nathan, a kid that I work with, and it was done on Shapeways. And it's really for my Launch Me Academy training, but I asked him, can you make me a rocket that's sort of vaguely in the style of the 1950s, lost in space, with rivets and all of those things? So he designed this, and I bought it on Shapeways, and now he's selling. It's an amazing time to be an educator. We can do almost anything, anything our imaginations and our kids' imaginations will allow. What are we going to allow? And what are we going to learn? How we push the envelope to engage learners and help them launch. Thanks for watching.
Hi, everybody. Guess what? We are almost done with the Apollo 13. We've only got a few more minor things left to do, some finish line photos, and we have to put together like the two halves, and then we'll be done entirely. Woo-hoo!